This is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our worship team will now lead us in a time of praise and worship. Please sing along with us.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. It's really good to see everyone here today. And as we begin this morning's service, I'd just like to ask you to just take the time, just a few seconds to focus and gather so that as we go into praise and worship with the praise team, we can really, you know, give our all and give praises to God for just allowing us to be here today. So we invite the praise team now to lead us in praise and worship.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All right, not bad, but I feel like we can do better. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Yes, we are here to praise the Lord. We are here to worship Him. Because indeed, God has been a strength. He's been a source of encouragement. He's been the one to whom we can look in our times of anxiety, distress, everything. So that's going to be the focus of our praise and worship today. We want you to worship alongside with us, to dance, to do whatever you want, as we glorify our Heavenly Father. Please stand with us.
Hear my cry, hear my cry, O Lord, attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than
we
God, that we look to you as the source of our strength. We don't look inwards, we don't look down, we don't look to the side, we don't look to our friends, oh God, but we look to you.
What to do,
oh, and I will love. to see things like you do. God, I look to you.
You am
a helper's rock.
Give me vision, Lord.
Oh,
you know just what to do.
You know just what to do.
Oh, and I will love you, Lord, my strength.
I will love you, Lord, my strength.
for lifting me up, because he is our strength. I ask you to just bow your heads with me as we go into prayer. Lord, Father God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, we just come to you today just to acknowledge your presence and to give thanks to you, God, because you are the gracious God, the merciful God, the God from before with Daniel, God, with Abraham, God, the God now and the God in the future, God. Lord, I just want to just big you up and give you thanks. They're not words that I can express, Lord, because I'm not worthy enough, God, but we were created on this earth to just worship and to just praise you, God. So I just want to give thanks and just give gratitude for the simple things, because sometimes God is working stuff for us, you know, and we don't really know, but he's doing things for us in the background, you know, and we just want to just thank you for things that are yet to come, God. Lord, I just want to just you know, thank you for, you know, allowing us to just be here to fellowship together, Lord. It could have been a case where we weren't able to come to church, but, you know, persons, however numbers are here, and, you know, those that are watching online, Lord, will have this time to just reflect and to just worship you. Lord God, I just really just pray for today's service, Lord. Lord, that persons will, you know, come and just, you know, focus and listen, Lord. And, you know, when they're talking about to find this good news, Lord, in times of peril, in times of trouble, Lord. You know, as we go through, you know, this crisis, this pandemic, Lord, after a couple times, Lord, we feel alone, probably we feel shaken, probably we feel like, you know, there's no help. But as the praise team said, you are my strength, you are my rock, you are my shield. And sometimes when there's no one else to turn to, God, we can turn to you. We can turn to you for strength. And sometimes we feel like, oh, we have to do this by ourselves. And that's when, you know, we get frustrated, angry, Lord. But we need to remember that we can come to you. We can come to you for strength, Lord, because I cannot be here leading by my own strength, Lord, because you're the one that gave me the strength to be here, Lord. So sometimes we have to just take that time to just think on you and just rely on you, and to read your word and to pray, God. Lord, I just ask you to just bless, you know, the preacher that will be coming, and to bless his word that he will, you know, minister unto his people, Lord. I just ask you to guide and protect each and every one of us that is here or that is listening online, Lord. I just ask you to really just give a covering over us during this week and as we, you know, go to work or try to live, you know, our daily lives, Lord, because we need your protection and guidance. So, Lord, I just ask you to just once again, you know, to guide us during this time. And, Lord, we just thank you one more time for being the God who you are, for always being with us, even when, you know, we think we are alone. In these we pray. Amen. So now I will invite our youth secretary, Sister Esther Hines, to give us the welcome and the announcement. So please welcome her as she comes.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to yet another lovely church service. Today is Youth Sunday and the penultimate evangelistic service. Warm welcome to everyone worshiping with us, whether you are here in Edgewater or joining us online. However, if this is your very first time in the sanctuary, please stand so we can acknowledge you. Anyone? No? Oh. Welcome. We are so happy that you are here. We hope you have been blessed by the service so far, and pray that you will continue to be blessed throughout this worship service. If there's anyone that was away but is now home, a special welcome to you. Is there any such person here today? No? Okay. Special welcome to our preacher and leader. Our preacher this morning is Reverend Andrew Henry. His objective is to be the vehicle by which the life-giving truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ is conveyed, and to be faithful to the word of God, which is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes, Romans 1, verse 16. He is the founder and co-host of Holiness Today, aired by TBC Radio. He is the senior pastor of Richmond Park Church of the Nazarene. He is married, and the union has produced 3 beautiful children. Welcome, Reverend Henry, to you and your family. We earnestly await the word of God that has placed in your heart. The leader of today's worship service is Sister Cherie Harris. She is a very talented woman of God. She dances, she signs, and on occasion, she is recruited to sing. How can I forget? She is one of our vice presidents for the Youth Fellowship. Welcome, Cherie, and welcome to your family as well. Thank you for availing yourself to serve us in this way. Welcome to our musicians. Thank you for using your talents to serve the Lord. As previously mentioned, today is Youth Sunday. Big up to all the youths who are in the sanctuary and those listening online. Our Youth Fellowship PRO would normally deliver the youth announcements and updates. However, our executive assistant, Keandra Foxton, will be doing the honors this morning. Sick and shut-in members. As a church family, we continue to pray for our sick and shut-in members. If you are able, we encourage you to call, text, or check up on these members of our church family. Our sister Joan Prendergast will be doing a surgery this Thursday, January 28th, and it is in urgent need of blood. She is kindly asking any willing church member to donate blood on her behalf. If you would like to assist, please give your name to Sister Hall Turner and or Deacon Hemmings. Death notices. As a church, we would like to offer condolences to Sisters Roden Brown, Kathia Davis, and Keandra Foxton on the death of their aunt and grand aunt, respectfully. Let us keep them in our prayers. A memorial service will be held next Thursday, January 21, at 3 p.m. The link will be sent out, and a private funeral will follow. A memorial service will be held for the mother of Sister Patricia Malcolm at the Bethel Baptist Church in Halfway Tree on Saturday, January 30, 2021, at 10 a.m. The church can only facilitate 30 persons. Garvey-Mead class members wishing to attend, please speak to our class leader. Also, a gratitude card was sent to us by the Hendricks family, and it reads, Pastor Dallin Toussaint and members of the Edgewater Baptist Church, thank you. I am truly touched by your kind gesture, your prayers, calls, and text messages during our time of bereavement. The Hendricks family appreciates your thoughts of sympathy, which gives us strength to go on the passing of our Mr. Melvin Bartholomew Hendricks, our dad, Brother Valen Hendricks. Please take note of the following. We continue to observe all government restrictions and regulations in relation to COVID-19. If you know someone who may be in need of counseling, please encourage them to make contact with our counseling and prayer hotline. The number to call is 876-220-6474. That is 876-220-6474. The Evangelism Committee would like to remind us that the weekly corporate prayer and fasting meetings continues this Saturday. The intervals for fasting are 6 a.m. to 12 noon, 6 a.m. to 3 p.m., or 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. We will meet face-to-face in the sanctuary from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. The Brotherhood and Hellshire, or Greater Portmore class, will be leading this session. All government restrictions and regulations in regard to COVID-19 will be observed. The closing exercise takes place this Saturday, 6 to 8 p.m. on Zoom. The link will be distributed. The team wants to express gratitude for the tremendous support as they continue to fast and pray for our church and the various other missions. Please contact your class leader if you don't already have the prayer points. Council members, please be reminded that the next council meeting will be held on the first Sunday in February, that is February 7, 2021. Good morning, class and auxiliary leaders. Please remember to send in your photos and or videos to the 2020 year in review presentation this weekend. Please send them to ebcyearinreview@gmail.com. That is ebcyearinreview@gmail.com. A special invitation was extended to us from the Portmore Moravian Church in celebration of their 39th anniversary. Deacon Derek Otte is presently at the service representing us. He is also celebrating 37 years of marriage today, so we may congratulate him and keep him in our prayers. All married and engaged couples are invited to the Couples Ministry Pre-Valentine's Social under the theme, Love is Real, Let's Keep It Real with Romance, on Saturday, January 30 at 6:30 p.m. via Zoom. Also, prayer and fasting will be held this Ash Wednesday, February 17 of this year. There will be a members' meeting on Sunday, February 23, so all church members, please keep note of this. The church is having a webinar training. Those who want to participate or learn how to host a meeting, persons can call in their name to the church office, Deacon Claudette Hemmings or Deacon Leachman. Sunday school today is being held at 2 p.m., so all children, please come out to learn God's word. Another note, the church is reminding you that you still cannot park on the church grounds due to the paving project. Birthdays and anniversaries. Happy anniversary to anybody celebrating an anniversary during this week. If so, we invite you to stand so we can acknowledge you. No one? Okay. If there's anyone celebrating a birthday this week, please stand. For those watching and celebrating a birthday or anniversary this week, we celebrate with you as well. I will now invite Keandra to bring us the youth announcements. Have a blessed week.
Hey everybody, it's time for the youth update. It's 2021 and we're hoping a most prosperous year for everyone. Children's Church will continue via the Zoom platform at 12:30 p.m. every first, second, third, and fifth Sundays. They will be focusing on the Ten Commandments until March. The 11th Unwritten Commandment will also be enforced. All children should keep in touch with God and attend Children's Church. There has been a decline in attendance since the holiday, and we are encouraging members to share the invitation to family and friends, even if they are not members of the Edgewater Baptist Church. If you don't already have access to the link, please speak to Sister Jennifer Morgan. Family Bible Hour is now online every fourth Sunday at 2 p.m. Classes resume today, January 24th, 2021. Please reach out to the respective teachers for the link or speak to Sister Kamala Dawkins, our Sunday School Superintendent. As the Youth Fellowship continues with their theme for 2020 to 2021, we struggled reliable God. The youth are reminded and encouraged to join meeting every Friday at 7:30 p.m. No meeting has been kept so far for the month of January, but the youth were kept engaged through weekly devotional exercises. Meetings resume very soon, and it will be much more exciting, much more engaging, and more real. So please follow us on Instagram at EBC_YF for more information, or speak to any member of the Youth Fellowship Executive for updates. We also want to say a huge big up to our Youth Fellowship President, Sister Tiffany Campbell, and member, Sister Bettina Lloyd, on their completion of their university studies and their participation in the recently held virtual graduation ceremony. Continue to be the great determined woman you are. And we speak that you can, and we ask that you continue to allow God's purpose for your life to be executed, Let them be an example for all the members of the Youth Fellowship and the younger members of the church to do their best in their studies and to understand that nothing is impossible if you don't depend on God. The Youth Fellowship will be having their our annual praise night on February 26, 2021. It promised to be a very enriching, transforming, pulsating, and a mind-blowing experience. More details will be announced soon. Those were the youth updates for January 2021. Thank you for listening.
Thank you once again to Sister Esther Hines and Kiandra for giving the updates and the youth announcements. So now we're just going to take this time to go into our, you know, offerings, tithes and offerings. So we just ask the ushers to come forward, and we will be, you know, following the 6 feet social distances as we come in the middle of the aisle and go around. And you will await as the ushers instruct you. So just bow your heads as we pray. Lord, I just want to thank you again for allowing us to, you know, give back just a portion of what you have given to us. And as we, you know, you have given us so much, Lord, and we just want to help to, you know, build back and to build back your church as, you know, we go through different activities. So Lord, I just ask you that as we, you know, give unto you, that we will give with a grateful heart, with a thankful heart, a cheerful giver. In these, I would just ask you to bless the offering, and whatever it will be used for, it will be used to glorify and to worship you for your ministry here at Edgewater. So we thank you once again. These we pray. Amen.
Are you in need of counseling and prayer in this time of crisis? The Edgewater Baptist Church, in association with Love 101 FM, the family station, invite you to call 876-220-6474. If you're in need of prayer and counseling, this is a new ministry of the Edgewater Baptist Church. All youths are invited to our online youth fellowship meetings, Fridays at 7:30 p.m. Speak to any youth leader or follow us on Instagram at EBC_YF for more information. Please be in touch with your respective class leaders for information and any updates. Remember the sick and shut-ins. Please call if you can and keep them in your prayers. The Edgewater Baptist Church continues to stand tall as a beacon of hope to many in and around its environs. The church ministry grew and continues to grow. Over the years, the church made improvements to its physical structure. Now, our churchyard needs paving and we need your support. In March, we launched our church paving project. This was since put on hold because of the COVID crisis. If you wish to make a contribution, make your checks payable to the Edgewater Baptist Church or call our church office at 876-988-4734 or send us an email at edgewaterbaptist@gmail.com for more information. The Edgewater Baptist Church, knowing Christ and making Him known since 1978.
You ever hear Earthquake call and say, "Hello, Miss Lee, yes, it's me, Earthquake, I come in Tuesday around 10? No, sir. Earthquake does arrive unannounced, and when it come, it shake all sense and sensibility out of we. Remain calm, stay inside, and do the DCH. Drop, hover, hold on. Once the shaking starts, you know it's Earthquake. Make a quick move to a safe place. Don't run to the door, we are in the exit. Stairs might broke up or full of people. Elevator, avoid that, because you might get in and poof, power gone, and you're stuck in that box without air. Take cover under a strong table or a bed, or crouch against an inside wall or in a corner, and cover your face and your head with your arms. Remember, DCH, drop, cover, hold on. Glass windows and doors, outside walls and doors, in an earthquake, bad news. Take care of yourself. Most injuries during earthquakes happen when something drop and hit people entering or exiting a building. Last thing, don't want to run outside and ask, "You feel it, you feel it?" Remain calm, stay indoors until all the shaking stop, and do the DCH, drop, cover, hold on.
And thank you, musicians. We'll be now, as we, you know, gave monetary offerings, we'll now give up our voices as we go into the theme song for these evangelistic services. So we just invite the praise team to come with us.
We invite you to stand with us.
A mountain that I've never faced before. That's why I'm calling on the Lord. I know it's been a while, but Lord, please hear my prayer. I need you like I never have before. Sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert to get a hold.
Forgive me, Jesus, I thought I could control whatever life would throw my way. But this I will admit has brought me to my knees. I need you, Lord, and I'm not ashamed to say.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Oh.
to trust you and me.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Sometimes it takes a mountain.
Oh Lord.
Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert.
Mountain. And during this pandemic, we can know that God is such a faithful God. God is such a stronger God. Is such a reliable God during these times of struggles. You know, we can look to Him and go to Him. We don't have to do this on our own, but we can rely on Him. So as we just prepare for the word that will come to us, we will invite Sister Carol Thorpe to do a special item. And immediately after which, then Reverend Henry will come to bring the word. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. All right, so I hope we're all doing well. I hope that everything is going splendid. Today is just supposed to really be a reminder of what we already know, and what we know is true.
Who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Let all creation testify. Let this life within me cry. Every same God that spins things in orbit runs to the weary, the born and the weak, and the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken.
Testify, let this life within me cry. Hallelujah. 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 My Redeemer lives. I think the expressions today are very, very striking within the body of Christ. There is no doubt that right here in Edgewater, there are God's people, the saints in Christ, who know that very well. My Redeemer lives. Doesn't matter what's happening around us. Doesn't matter what's going on, COVID or not. My Redeemer, He lives. I wish somebody would praise him in the house today. I wish there are more persons who will recognize this today. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, it is my very humbling privilege to be asked to be God's servant at this time, to stand where perhaps your own pastor would be standing, to share the undiluted word of God. I do not take this assignment lightly. I believe that when God calls us to minister His word, that we should be humbled by the fact that God would have chosen us. And so I want to bring you greetings on behalf of my own family and on behalf of the Richmond Park Church of the Nazarene family. Even though we are in Kingston and you're here in St. Catherine, we serve a God who is everywhere. We serve a God who loves us. And we serve a God who is mindful of us. And so this morning, as we come, I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Acts. Acts, the 16th chapter. And for many, perhaps it's one of those books that we go to when we need some action. But it's more than just action in the physical sense. It is action in the Holy Spirit. It is where God would have directed His church to move according to His bidding. And we are called to do the same. Will you stand in honor of God's word with me and remain standing as I'll pray following the reading. Acts chapter 11, I pick up at verse 11 onward through to the 40th verse. You may be saying, Pastor, it's a long passage. But after all, we're in church. Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, and the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia, and a colony. And we were in that city abiding certain days. And on the Sabbath, we went out of the city by a riverside where prayer was wont to be made, and we sat down and spake unto the woman which resorted thither. A And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worshiped God, heard us, whose heart the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. And when she was baptized and her household, she besought us, saying, if ye have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house and abide there. And she constrained us. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us, and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee, in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains was gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city, and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. When they had laid many stripes on them, they cast them into the prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's hands were loose, or bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prisoner's doors open, he drew his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Hallelujah. Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in the house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his, straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. And when it was day, the magistrate sent the sergeant, saying, let those men go. And the keeper of the prison told this saying to Paul, the magistrates have sent to let you go. Now therefore depart and go in peace. But Paul said unto them, they have beaten us openly, uncondemned, being Romans, and have cast us into prison. And now do they thrust us out privately? Nay, verily, or privily. But let them come themselves and fetch us out. And the sergeants told them words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them and brought them out, and desired to depart out of the city. And they went out of the prison and entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed. This is a word of the Lord. Almighty God, we thank you for the written word. And now as you speak, the spoken words go out, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus, that you'll minister to our hearts and to our lives today. Lord, have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Good news in troubled times. And I'll take the liberty to add a different perspective. Good news in troubled time. Brothers and sisters, in this account in Acts 16, we see where the Apostle Paul visited the Roman colony of Philippi. And there he had a dramatic encounter with the empire. We'll read, as you would have read, and we continue to look in the scripture about the various things that Paul was met with as he entered the colony of Philippi. I believe likewise, there is so much going on around us right now. So many things are happening. Like Paul, as he went to Philippi, he came upon the leaders. He came upon Lydia. He came upon others who needed Jesus. He came upon diviners. He came upon persons who were given gain or receiving out of divination. Here was Paul, brothers and sisters, being met with a number of challenges as he was in Philippi. Today, I'm here to say to somebody, like our world, there are so many challenges that we are faced with. Amen. So many things are going on around us. There is the loss of jobs for some, frustration for others, of course, depression, anxiety, suicidal thoughts, among other things, as a result of COVID or unrelated to COVID. There are those who are feeling a level of abandonment. There are those, like those in school, who are having problems accessing online education. They simply don't have the resources. Or if they do, they simply cannot connect because they are having connectivity issues. Then there are the parents who are having serious problems, because if you're like what I know, when they are at home, then they will eat more. Oh, that's only me. They are not here. They are not watching. They are not here. So many other challenges. The increase in the utilities. Hey, the light, the water, the telephone, the air condition, because they will also tell you they are hot. And the fans can't work. Brothers and sisters, we see every day around us persons who are saying, I can't simply manage. Simply, I cannot manage. I cannot go on. I am just stressed. Yes, it's in the church as well. For those in some communities, you go to bed with the guns and you wake with it. The violence continues to be your neighbor. The violence puts you to bed and it wakes you up. There are those who want a peaceful life. There are those of us who are now mindful of what the future holds. What will happen? We hear about vaccine, and we're hearing about needs locally, and we are hearing all kinds of talk about what we are going to do to reset and to fix mankind and to fix our situation. And persons, we are even now hearing from our own legislators about the possibility of abortion becoming a free for all, as you want to access it. Face with these and more. And so the voices are not just talking, but now we reach shouting stage. You hear them? Do you hear them? They are shouting at us. They are shouting at the church. They are shouting from the pews. They are shouting at the back. They are shouting at the front. They are shouting in the hallways. They are shouting when you go to the supermarket. They are shouting when you look at somebody like that 16-year-old. When you look at somebody and they don't like how you look at them, then abuse comes. They are shouting. They are shouting. They are shouting. We are tired. What does the church do? What does the church do? The church cannot just look at herself, but the church has to look outside. The good news, in troubled times, a different perspective says, whilst we work with us within, I must also look at the alternative. I must also provide a different perspective then. I must also reach across the aisle, reach outside of the walls of my house, the walls of the church, reach to my friends at school, my co-workers, reach to all those who may not know Jesus and share with them this good news. And perhaps you're wondering, Pastor, what this good news is. Well, Mark 1:15 tells us what that good news is. Jesus, in his first sermon recorded in Mark, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news. That's the good news, that Jesus' kingdom is at hand, and we must repent. The good news, in other words, is that there is an alternative way to the way people are living. I hold up this book that my wife has written. And in this book that she has written, named Loose to Live, she recounts some of her own experiences having to do with particular ladies, and our own women's groups all over in the denomination. And what she has chronicled is quite mind-boggling. There has to be an alternative to a stolen purpose. That there are so many young people and older people who have lost their purpose. The devil has stolen your purpose. Congratulations to those I heard who graduated. And I believe even if you don't get to graduation stage and you are doing something purposefully, God bless you. We have to provide an alternative to this enemy's lies that he tells us we are good for nothing. A feeling of emptiness. We have to provide an alternative to this victimization that is going on around us, within the church and outside of the church. Those who believe I can't go beyond failure. Failure run me down like blessing. And he comes and he hugs me. And he tells me I am his own. And he walks with me. And he talks with me. All that spews out of their mouth. I am good for nothing. I can't be. It's an inferiority complex. We have to provide an alternative to know that even though I make mistakes, I have the ability to get up and go again. There's lots more from her book. But I just thought of letting you know that the good news should come to address those things. So what Jesus said to his disciples and others, he said that the gospel is an alternative way for people to understand that even though humans live a particular way, when it comes to the kingdom of God, when it comes to gospel, when it comes to Jesus Christ, there is a better way. That's the good news, the kingdom of God. So we come to Acts 16. And I want to propose to us that as we talk about good news in troubled times, to look at Paul's journey here and his encounters, what good news, Pastor, there can be? The first encounter has to do with Lydia, verses 11 through to 15. He said that he met Lydia. Lydia was a woman of wealth and status. But you know what stood out from 11 to 15? When she heard the gospel, she responded by opening her heart and then her resources, her house. That's the good news. The good news has to be that, first of all, if we're going to make a change, that we must be willing to open our hearts. There are too many, can I say it here, cold-hearted, back home I would say dog-hearted. There are too many of us in church whose hearts are cold. We have lost what it means to have any emotions, anything that warms the heart. We have grown so cold to the needs around us, within the church, out of the church. We can't even open our hearts to the love of God and to love others in return. So the first thing here, if we're really going to affect anything positively in this hard time, we have to begin by opening our hearts. What is it that Jesus wants me to do? How can I make a positive impact in my church? How can I make a positive impact where I spend quite a number of hours in the day? How can I make a positive impact to those in my house? How can I make young people a positive impact to my friends that I have? And the link is them on social media. Twitter, Instagram, Spotify. What are the name of it? All the social media them. How am I going to make a positive impact? Lydia opened her heart. And when she opened her heart, the scripture tells us, she said, everything belongs to God. Everything. Lydia, rich Lydia from Thyatira, worship God. When we open our hearts, we will worship God. Nobody has to force us. Nobody has to propel us. Nobody has to say, come, let's worship God. Because it's not just a Sunday morning at 10 o'clock worship service, but our lives will worship God every day that we live. So the question I want to ask, what of our gifted resources? Because Lydia did not only open her heart, though she started there, but she opened her resources. She said, no, come, all these things are yours. Verse 15, she said, when she was baptized, she and her household, she besought them, saying, it's the same thing, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come into my house, abide here. And she begged them. What we have is not for us alone. It's not for us alone. She constrained them. So Lydia, like Lydia, we are called brothers and sisters. The good news is supposed to be translated this way, where my heart is open and I am open to what God wants to do with me. Like the widow in Zarephath. Do we know that story well? The widow in Zarephath, Elijah said unto her, she said, I don't have anything much, the last meal. But the Bible tells us that Elijah said to her, according to 1 Kings 17, Elijah said, go and bake, don't fear. You just do what I've said. Bake me a little cake first and bring it to me. And afterward, you're going to make something for yourself and your son. For the Lord say your jar of flour shall not be spent, and your jug of oil shall not be empty in 1 Kings 17. Open your treasures, church. Come on. Can I get us to change our mentality? We may be saying, Pastor, I thought you were coming to just tell me about how I can just walk over some troubles. But I want to tell you this morning, as I grapple with this word, that God wants us to say, if you're going to go through your troubles, you must start by opening your hearts to me. Is that too hard? Let's go on. I could tell you of the many encounters that refer to opening your hearts. But the second one has to do in verse 16 through to 18. This second encounter, we're talking about good news in troubled time. Open your heart. This one has to do with Paul's encounter with the slave girl. It came to pass, as they went to prayer, the damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her master's gain. The same followed Paul and cried, these men are the servants of the Most High God. This girl was said to be possessed by the Python spirit. She had a gift of speaking the truth and predicting the future, but it was at a cost to somebody. Somebody gets also the benefit. She was possessed, but she was controlled by greedy men. I'm saying, the good news in troubled time is to find that person, that slave girl, that girl who is out there going on and doing her stuff, but is benefiting some strong back somebody. Somebody who is benefiting from her around back road, benefiting from her in an abusive situation, benefiting from her. The Bible says Paul could not take it anymore. Paul says, in the name of Jesus, Python spirit, come out. I wish somebody would understand that God has given us that authority. And you may know somebody. I was reading the UNICEF report of 12th July, and I've been told by the agencies, the Child and Family Services Agency and the OCA, Office of Advocate, and United Nations Children Fund, and all those people, that Jamaica, since this pandemic, you know, that they are concerned about the heightened form of abuse, including sexual violence, as children now spend more time at home and in the care of some adults that we know have ulterior motives. And the report continues to say that sexual abuse has been a pervasive challenge. In fact, we are told 1 in 4 Jamaican adolescent girls between 15 and 19 experience sexual violence in their lifetime. The point I'm making, church, that you and I, if we're talking about good news in troubled time, cannot sit all of these fans in Edgewater and solve this problem through prayer alone. We must find that girl, those girls, those children who are victims of violence and crime, and tell them Jesus loves them. How am I going to do that? By the authority of Jesus. Come on, church, we have it within us. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell. I like the fact that announcement was made about the counseling department, ministry of the church. But many of us don't go counseling, for we believe that we pass counseling. And we're too Christianized, so we don't need the counseling. But I want to say to perhaps there's a person here, somebody watching, somebody who's being abused, you are being victimized, something that you have never said. It was Rick Warren in his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, in one of the chapters said, we are all products of our past. There are some things we don't have any control over. Where you were born, to whom you were born, and if you're born on the bed, are you born on the floor, are you born on a jubilee, are you born somewhere else? cancer. We never had any control over that. But as we grow, as we mature, as we grow in Christ as believers, there are some things we can, come on church, under God, take some authority over. Even though I bond on a bush, even though I've had a terrible past, even though I've got whippings and lashes and those things, I have purpose in my heart, in myself, forgetting the things which are behind. I'm going to strain forward. Abuse, go. Molestation, go. Go behind me, Satan. Get thee behind me. I'm going to seek the counseling. I'm going to seek the deliverance. I'm going to get some help, because in the name of Jesus, it must go. Can be in the church for years and have not dealt with the baggages. In fact, studies have shown that the church is one of the places that has so many baggages, because we can be fooled by the devil to think that because we are Christians, we don't have to deal with it. There are persons in here who maybe you're struggling with unforgiveness. Good news in trouble time, God wants to get you over that one, so that you can deal with the troubles that are coming. There are those who here who have not spoken to a family member for a number of years. Malice are in the church because somebody did say something you never like, or a pastor put somebody if you do something you never like, or this did say something you never understand it, and you walk away thinking, say, I made them a chat and them not like me. But I'm here to tell you that God wants you, in the name of Jesus, get it out. Do not allow the past to determine your future. So it ends. Rick Warren says, we are all products of our past, but we do not have to remain prisoners of it. Are there prisoners of their past today? Is there anyone in Edgewater Baptist Church watching, listening to me, that your past has held you captive? You're under holy shackles and chains. You have been bruised and battered by that man in that abusive relationship, that woman. You have been told some words by your parents when you're growing up, some words that can't talk over the pulpit. You have been told by your big sister, your brother, whatever. You have been told some things by those who cared for you, that right now you are lopsided, one-winged, one eye, one hand, one foot. You can't think balance. Good news, in troubled time, Jesus has come to set you free, in the name of Jesus. Quickly, let me go to the third encounter, 19 to 22. This was now with the slave owners. When the masters learned that the girl was being freed, them never like it. Did they laugh? No. They rose up, according to verse 22 of Acts 16. Together against them, and the magistrates rent their clothes and they commanded that they be beaten. That was it. This had a real confrontation. The gospel set the girl free. The good news came, but there are those who are determined to keep her. Come on, church. I don't know where you are today, but I can hear somebody saying, I am determined not to remain in bondage. Hallelujah. My spirit is telling me that there's somebody in Edgewater, somebody watching. You are saying, this January 24, I am going to make a decisive effort. I am going to go to God. I'm going to get the help, the counseling, because I've not been sleeping. I've not been eating. I have been having hypertension. I've been having all kinds of somatic and psychosomatic issues and psychological issues and physical and neurological issues, because I have not dealt with some things. The magistrates wanted to keep her in darkness. Do you know that there's one person who's lined up behind you to keep you in darkness? The Bible says Satan comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I'm here to tell you, God wants to loose you so that you can live today. God wants to set you free so that you can live today. Where is Edgewater this morning? I feel the Holy Ghost in your pulpit, Pastor. God is saying this Sunday morning, no more living below the standard. No more one drop, one drop, one drop. You're in and you're out like you're playing some chess or checker. I am going to serve God with all my heart, because whether the devil thought he had a prize on my head, I come to tell him this Sunday morning, it is over. Come on, church, worship God. They had the economic gain. So with all of that, they dragged the man of God, the men of God, into prison. Who are the slave owners among you today? Who are the slave owners among us today? Who are those who continue to have a hold on your life? Because every time you walk around with them. Who are those persons who occupy your bedtime? Who occupy your mealtime? Who are those persons who every time you sit down to relax, they come in the front of your brain? Who are those persons that you can't seem to let go? You hear their voices. You hear their cries. You hear their pleas. And you also hear their words of condemnation in your head. And you say, oh, a curse. Oh, a hobby, science. Oh, no. The enemy has set out to destroy you. And it's playing with your minds right now. And it's telling you you can never come back. Because at 20 years you're like this, or 15 or 10 years, you're born this way. Come on, don't believe that lie. Don't believe that lie. Jesus can and he has set you free. Come on, I want you. If you know it, and you know it, and you know it, then rejoice. I am free. So the devil has a bottom line, but Jesus has one too. Jesus has one too, and his is greater. The kingdom of God is greater than the kingdom of darkness. So whatever bottom line the enemy has, he wants to keep you bound and keep us down and keep us under his feet, because he feels that that's better for us. We are rising up. There's a vast army. Come on, let's go down to the valley of dry bones in Ezekiel chapter 37. And when Ezekiel looked around him, he saw dry bones. The Bible said that there for many, 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 many years, there were no sinews. There was no hope of them coming back. Dry, dead, decay. Use all the adjectives you can find. There was a simply no hope to see anything happening here. But when God spoke with Ezekiel, son of man, can these, Jesus have mercy, son of man, can Edgewater live? Can those who are watching on Facebook, social media, can they live? Can they come out of their, oh Lord, their valley? Can they overcome? Can we? Can we? Can we experience victory and victory and victory? Victory. The man of God looks at God and said, thou knowest. For you know that anything you call will come back to life. Lazarus, oh Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. God, you know. Just speak, God said to him. Come on. Speak the word. I wish somebody to start to speak over them life right now. I wish somebody in Edgewater would start to speak to your issues right now. Open your mouth, man, and say, in the name of Jesus, me I go on my bed tonight and me go sleep. Me I go and go eat me dinner. Me, Lord have mercy. Me not live like this anymore. It may be a sickness in your body. I'm taking control and authority in the name of Jesus. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe the report. Slave owners die. Slave owners die. Slave owners in my life die. 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 Jesus' name. The magistrates, verses 22 to 24, realizing what was going on, the Bible says they would have ordered the beating of Paul and Silas, having torn their clothes because they know what was happening. They commanded that they be beaten and they be placed in stock, and the jailer put them in the innermost part. What do I do when I'm in the innermost part? What do I do when they thought it's over? What do I do when those political authorities thought that they can keep God's kingdom down? What do I do when needs is coming? What do I do when our leaders are saying something else? What do I do as a church? What do I do as an individual? What do I do? Well, the Bible says, even though Paul and Silas were placed in the innermost part of the prison, and I'm told by research, it is a dungeon. It is what intersects the other prison doors. And so all the dirty sewage water flows through it, and wet and all kinds of things, and heavy stocks on their feet to keep their feet down. Perhaps swelling would be a result. But the Bible said, come on, church, you can't keep God's people. I wish I may one in a church I preach, but I don't think so. Only power we have preached today. You cannot. The good news is, in this troubled time, the church is alive and well. Paul says, nothing shall separate me from the love of God, which in Christ Jesus. No height, no depth, nothing above, nothing below, nothing under. No matter where, nothing shall separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. The church, Jesus said it. The church, I am building my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That's the good news in troubled time, that the church is going on. The church has won and continues to win. Come on. Victory is ours. We are more than... I wish somebody would take that word home today. Put your name there. I am Andrew. You are more than conqueror in Christ Jesus. Fifthly, good news in troubled time. Look at the jailer, 25 to 27. At midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises. Then there was a great earthquake. The foundation of the prison was shaken. The doors were open. Bands were loose. The keeper of the prison came and said, "You kill myself, got him gone. What can I do?" The good news here is that even in our sticky situation, when we worship God, something happens. Lord, have mercy. Come on. Can I get some worshippers in Edgewater this afternoon, this morning? Can I get some worshippers? Don't be afraid, man. You may not see it, but it's working. Come on. You may not understand it, but it's working. Come on. God is good, church. The Bible says Paul and Silas had worship. Right there in the Bible. Man in a pain. Man in dungeon. Man left to die, as it were. But at midnight, at the point when everything was the most quiet, at the point when everybody would be going after like a snooze, at the point where everybody's saying, okay, we have it locked, the day is done, God would have awakened a worshipful spirit. Sometimes all you can do at the point of breaking, just start to worship. Sometimes all you can do at the point of you giving up, just start to worship. Can I get a witness in Edgewater? At the point when the devil say, I have you down, you are bound, you are down, down, down. Just say, Lord, you know,
You know, it's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. Nothing can compare to your worship. Oh God, yesterday he was hanging out at Lydia's house, but today he's behind bars, but that no stop his worship. Yesterday seemed was good, but today the sun no shine for you in your life. But worship God, lift up your hands, lift up your voice, and give God worship. It was in worship that God caused an earthquake to come. I can hear God saying, I'm moving out some things in your worship. Come on. There's a tsunami coming to your house. There's a tsunami coming to your life. There's a tsunami coming in your circumstance. There's a magnitude earthquake that can never be recorded on a Richter scale. For God is telling you, oh, your doors are open. You don't need any key. You don't need any jailer. You don't need anybody to put in a key in the locker, because God is opening your doors. That's the good news. What must I do to be saved? Finally, the last encounter we see it when the morning came. Verses 35 to 39, the magistrates gathered up and they sent a message. Tell the men of God to go away privately, for this is not normal. This is not normal. Let those men go, for it's not normal. Paul said, you beat us in public. You put us in prison, everybody can see. But I'm here to tell you now, Gosso. I know your circumstances have changed, your perspective have changed, but I want you to come and escort me. I am saying to us, the good news is that when we stand up for God, he will stand up for us. He will escort us. He will make everything bow to us. He will prepare a table in the presence of our enemies. He will anoint my head with oil. He will give me Psalm 1 verse 3 that tells me that even though I'm like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth my fruit in my season, my leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever I do shall prosper. So the enemies of Paul friend Paul and say, go, because it's not normal. Can I close this way? When we have the encounters with God, it's not normal. And not only you are going to realize it's not normal, but those around us will realize it's not normal. Even though we are in a pandemic and in a normal, there's a different kind of not normal. There are different kind of, you want to call it abnormal. It's not abnormal. There's something else, because God is going to raise up the church, and is raising up the church. Brothers and sisters, being citizens of heaven, let's understand that we have the authority, the rights, the privileges. We are royal priesthood, peculiar people, holy nation, no jacket, waistcoat, no bastard. We are God's children. Stand with me, please. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What good news today. They go riding. Come on. What good news. We are riding in the darkness today. What good news. Whatever comes my way, I know that Jesus have me. Hallelujah. Is there anyone today who feels that God is saying to you, step out? I think I'll exercise a privilege and ask you if you may social distance to come forward. I want to pray before I take my seat. The Lord is placing something. And maybe there is a cave that you're in. You're in the cave of Adullam that David spoke about. You're in the jailhouse, not literally, figuratively speaking. And God is telling you, come, because we're going to break those chains this morning. Your faith and this prayer will break it. And the prayer of the saints. Is there anyone else today? Hallelujah. Just step out from where you are. It is obedience to the word of God. It is following the word of God. Yes, come young people. Come, just understand. It has been broken this morning. Come on. It has been broken this morning. If you may, you can raise your hands in your seat as well. You know your situations. And I say, Lord, it is broken. By your blood, it is broken. You're changing the perspective. You're changing. I like Joseph's story. You're ambushing the devil and you put him down flat on his face with my worship. Somebody worship God. Somebody praise him. Somebody worship. Father! Yes.
No more chains holding me.
Jesus, come on. Yes.
My soul is resting.
Come on, church. Jesus.
It's such a blessing.
Come on. It doesn't matter where it comes from.
Praise
in the name of Jesus.
The Lord.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm free.
Are you free this morning?
I am free.
Are you free? Are you free from the cares and the bondages? The things that have held you for years.
No more chains holding me. My soul is resting. It's a blessing.
Jesus.
Praise the
Lord. One more time. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free.
I'm free.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
I refuse to live in bondage. Maybe you're not a Christian.
No
in the house.
Life,
you can come. You're in bondage. Sinful bondage. And the Lord is calling you as well. Is
praise
there anyone
the
saved? Of your seat as well. I'm free.
I'm free.
I'm free. Come and experience
praise
freedom.
Lord, free.
It's not
no
the absence of pain and scars and bruises, but it's giving them all to the glory of God.
It's such a blessing.
Such a blessing.
Praise the Lord.
One last time for somebody, as I feel led to pray. One last time.
I am free.
Somebody, this is your time.
Praise the Lord.
Just think about you, God.
No longer bound.
No longer bound.
No more chains holding me.
Yes.
My soul is resting.
Great change. Great change. Great change.
Praise the Lord.
As we come in response to his word, be it online or be it in the congregation, go ahead, church, and respond as the Holy Spirit leads you. Lord, we come against every chain that binds your people. Some have been placed on us by our belief system. We have come to believe the words that have been spoken to us and over us. Some, Lord, have grown into it. We have come as adults to take on what the world has given to us. And as a result, God, we are living a lie. The chains are knocking. The chains are real. We have been carrying this burden for years, for some of us. We sit in church, we participate, but Lord, our hearts are heavy. We go back home sometimes even more heavy than how we came. For the Holy Spirit deals with us, but we look at the chains, we look at the padlock, and we say, if I open this lock, there are too many skeletons in my closet. Jesus, mash down the closet today. Just take one sledgehammer and throw in our closet today. Jesus, if we have a ball, poop up, roll and ball. Jesus, if we have a run out, let us face that valley of dry bones today. Let us know that our God is able. The devil has been profiting on some of us lives for too long. And he has his cronies in different arenas who have been profiting by our own as well. Our own misgivings and belief systems. It's done. No more. We cut the chains through the blood of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit. It's a lie from the pit of hell. Satan, get thee behind us. Satan, you are defeated. We are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. We have the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We are living for Jesus. We are more than conquerors. So we thank you for this word today. Good news in troubled times, a different perspective. You want to do something differently through us, in us, and for us today. We receive your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Let the church say amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Amen. I would just really want to thank Reverend Henry for bringing this word today. And we just, you know, he reminded us that we can worship him through the good times and the bad times. That he's a great God that can break any chain. That he can free us from any situation that we might be going through. And you know that who the Son has set free is free indeed. So we're just, you know, going to take this time and we invite you to stand as we take the benediction.
So get ready to leave the house of God today as you raise your hand. We leave with you God's blessings. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you all and grant you his perfect peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. As Jesus wills us. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you will join us again as we worship together. Please remember to pray for each other. There is power in prayer. Have a blessed week.